Welcome to this very special event with our very special guest, Professor Mary Beard. Mary, as you, I'm sure you all know, is an academic and classicist who spent most of her career at Cambridge University, where she's written many books, most of them on the ancient world, including a Wolfson Prize-winning Pompeii, The Life of a Roman Town, and more recently, her books SPQR, A History of Ancient Rome, and most recently of all, Women and Power, both of which have become critically acclaimed bestsellers, and rightly so, Mary, am I saying?
I didn't say it.
Mind me saying, actually. Now, less well known is that Mary, I think it's your first single authored book, Mary, was not on the ancient, but on the modern. It was called The Good Working Mother's Guide. And it was a practical book on issues such as how to interview a nanny.
That's really good advice.
It's something very important to working fathers as well as working mothers, that one. I mentioned that book because it tells you quite a bit about Mary, the person, Mary in the present, as distinct from Mary the academic studying the past. Now, of course, as you all know, Mary is very much more than just an academic. She's classics editor of the Times Literary Supplement. She writes a wildly popular blog, a Don's blog, which has now, I think, formed two books.
Yeah.
You may well be featuring in it next week.
So that's not
got to write about something.
Not actually in my notes, that bit. But it's really on our TV screens and on our radio waves that Mary's really risen to national, indeed international, prominence over recent years. Her book on Pompeii was turned into a documentary, which I think really lit the public's imagination. And what's followed has been a sequence of documentaries and TV and radio programs ranging from the ancient, including Meet the Romans with Mary Beard, and the modern, such as Mary's appearance on Question Time. Mary's become one of, if not the, best known and, I reckon, best loved public intellectuals in the UK. And by that I truly mean a public intellectual, an academic who, for the general public, has brought her subject to life, right into their living rooms. That's very dangerous to sum up anyone in a single sentence, especially someone as multifaceted as Mary. But if I were to do so, I couldn't do much better than to quote a recent journalist who said of Mary recently, Mary is a celebrity, a national treasure. Don't take that the wrong way. And easily the world's most famous classicist. So please join me in welcoming to the Bank of England our very special guest, Professor Mary Beard. So I'm going to ask some questions. This is all live streamed, by the way. So you all know before you ask your questions. I have no skills whatsoever as an interviewer, as will quickly become apparent. But let me kick off, Mary, and then we'll open it up after about 20 minutes to you to ask some proper questions of Mary. Can I start at the beginning, actually, with classics and the choice of classics, which I think traditionally was, and maybe still is, a male-dominated discipline, like economics, actually.
Yeah.
And I wondered what it was that drew you into it.
There's all kinds of different answers to that. You know, one is I was good at it at school, you know, and I think, you know, if you're at a quiet academic, I was an academic girls' school, and you get to like what you're good at and you get to be good at what you like, and it's circular, and you like praise, and somehow, you know, you just you just slip into it. I mean, this is rather skating over the fact that maths was never, and physics was never quite what I was good at. But so there was a sort of, in some ways, I think there was no at school light bulb moment, but I did have a light bulb moment when I was about five, actually. And I lived in Shropshire, and my mum thought that it was time that I saw the capital city. So I came to London when I was five for a holiday. My mum was a teacher, so it was quite a sort of hardcore holiday, involving museums and things like that. And we went to the British Museum. And there was two things in the British Museum that I still remember. And one was going to see, and this is, terribly now iffy political point, but she took me to see the Elgin Marbles. And insofar as any five-year-old has ever kind of got a kind of teleological Whig view of progress, I had one. And I kind of assumed that somehow the history of the world was a history in which mankind got better as it went on. And when she told me that this was made 2,500 years ago, that was a completely, really undermined my sense of sort of how the world worked, that people could be so good at that all those years ago. And that was the first moment. But then, of course, I wanted to see not just the Greeks, but the Egyptians, and not only the mummies. And I was interested in everyday life. And the British Museum then was not child-friendly. All the cases were quite high. And my mum had spotted, at the back of one case, some carbonised Egyptian cake, which was something like 4,000 years old, right? This was even better than the Elgin Marbles, the idea that cake could survive. And she was trying, because I couldn't see it, because it was really too high and at the back, she had to put her bags down and she lifted me up, and it was still very awkward. And a guy came past at that moment who, I've got no idea who he was, but he must have been a curator. And he saw this slightly awkward scene of sort of middle-aged lady with bags lifting up, slightly large five-year-old. Came to the case, he got his keys out, he opened the case. He said, "What are you wanting to see?" And I said, "That bit of cake at the back." and he got the cake out. And in some ways, I think that, I don't know who the guy was, and I imagine he's long dead, but it was a real eye-opening moment, because it's not just the fact that this piece of Egyptian cake was fascinating, which in some ways, how could you not be fascinated by a piece of cake that's 5,000 years old? But the idea that somehow museum cases could be opened for you, that there were people who would show you things, that you would be interested in something, and it would be difficult to see, but there was someone on hand who'd help you. And I think I've probably mythologized too, but I've never ever lost that moment of just being struck in awe at the way the past could be opened up to you. And I think I saw, in some ways with the telly and stuff, I hope I'm doing what that that curator guy who opened the case once upon a time did for me, I suppose.
And you're still struck in awe by what the past can open up for us.
Yeah, I mean, people often say things like, where would you like to go back to in the ancient world? Who would you like to be? Nowhere, The ancient world was horrible. And, if you are a woman, even more horrible, So you make some joke about saying, "Can I have a day return, please, to ancient Rome?" Because, they would have been stuck there. But I think that, for me, what is so very awe-striking is the way the past is not only fascinating, and I think it depends what you get, what turns you on. But learning about Roman history turns me on. But it's the idea that it also makes you rethink what you think about yourself. Mm-hmm. When you study, or when I study, and I hope when I encourage my students to study the ancient world. I'm not encouraging them to bury their head in the past. You know, it is not nerdy entirely. Part of it's nerdy, but not all of it. But I'm encouraging them to use the dialogue that you have to have between yourself and the past to make yourself look differently at what you do. So I think that any study of history is both a study of what we've lost, but it's also, it kind of turns you into an anthropologist of your own world. You know, just to think, you know, how will we look, you know, in 2,000 years' time? You know, what will people be writing? What essays will they be writing about us? You know, what would the Romans find so puzzling about what we now do? It kind of defamiliarizes you with things that you otherwise take for granted. I think that's what it's got going for it. It's got some good literature and, you know, some lovely sculpture and pictures too, but that's not what really drives me.
And did you always know you'd become an academic? Or when did you know you'd become an academic?
My career like this sounds completely unplanned, and I suppose I'm pleased to say that, really. It's a continuation of wanting to go on with what I felt I was good at. Now, you might say this was an extremely boring way of not thinking about all the other things in life that might have been interesting. And I suppose I decided, and this sounds so bloody privileged when I say this, I decided that what I would do, I'm embarrassed even to say this, but in the interest of full disclosure, I will. I thought, if I get a first, I'll stay on and do research. If not, she said, never thinking that there was a little exam involved, I'll join the civil service.
Oh, really?
No. Revelation. Now, that was a revelation,
I think,
for you.
You know, when I think of that appalling self-confidence, you know, you might not have got in, you know. I shudder with embarrassment, but that was plan B. I think that maybe we were better off without each other anyway. So.
And in terms of plan Bs, was there ever a plan in your wildest dreams of taking your material to the mass audience that you now have?
No. I say no, but I was also brought up educationally in a world that is very different and which was, in a sense, fundamentally founded on a sense of the public responsibility of the academic. Mm. And I remember, you know, going back to my first day at university, and I was the first member of my family to get a degree. I know I can sense now that I look like someone who's, you know, a frightful old Oxbridge type who's kind of, you know, lived the dreaming spires forever. You know, I was, you know, my mum hadn't been able to afford to go to university to get a degree. Neither did my dad. So I was very much first generation uni. And I remember on the first day, my director of studies said, and this would no longer be true, the taxpayer is paying for you to do this course. That means you work a 5.5 day a week, 48 weeks a year, right? And that's basically what we did. Yeah. And there was a very, very strong sense of public responsibility. Mm-hmm. Now, this was not public responsibility in terms of necessarily mass dissemination, but it was, in a sense, saying, you know, the academic has a responsibility to the community. Now, I would love to say that to my students now, to say the taxpayer is paying you to do this, but in fact, it's their bloody loans that's paying for them. And it's a very different, changed world. But I always thought, and I was just brought up to think, and I never rethought the idea that, you know, basically, I was very, very lucky to be able to do what I want to do. Someone was paying me for it, and there was a duty to pay back. And I think there are many ways in which you can pay back. And, you know, God help us, I don't think everybody should be on the telly. I mean, you know, it would be a disaster. You know, and there's all kinds of different ways of paying back what I thought of as a debt. So telly came late to me, but it was, and I was quite reluctant to do it. And it was really only because the controller of BBC Two, Janice Hadlow, had taken my Pompeii book on holiday, and she'd read it, and she was looking for real historians to present history programmes and real women to present history programmes. And I kind of ticked both boxes. And she said, would I do a programme on Pompeii? And, I mean, I now I'm very pleased that I did. And I was always, obviously I was tempted, but I remember at first refusing, really, saying, oh, it's going to take a very long time. I knew what telly was like, you know, it was hours and hours of hanging around. And I also said, presciently, you know, if I did, I'm sure A.A. Gill wouldn't like the look of me on telly. I was too bloody right, too. and Janice eventually said, after I'd gone through all these things, she said, look, you complain. I know that you complain that... there's loads of wrinkly old men presenting history documentaries, but there's no wrinkly old ladies, right? Now, I am offering you a chance to present a documentary. You've not got the nerve to turn it down. And so at that point, I was snookered. You know, that was unanswerable. I did complain. You know, I did say, oh, look, you can be a Dimbleby and go on till you're, you know, 97, but, you know, women are retired from the screen at age 32. And she said, all right, take up the challenge then, darling. So I did.
And it's been fantastically successful.
For some.
So...
I'm sure that in many ways it has been successful, but, you know, there are critics as well as admirers, for good reason, I think.
And what would you... We surprised by that, how successful it was, and what... Have you thought about how it was you were able to reach parts that I guess you hadn't really planned that you could reach before?
I was surprised. I learned a lot in the course of making both the first film and the other one, so it was interesting to me. I think that... people often say, oh, you brought something new to this... You know, it was about everyday life. We looked at meet the Romans. We met the woman who was, you know, living in a ménage à trois with two blokes, but she died first. There was this long tombstone, you know, describing how wonderful her body was. You know, and you brought that to us, right? And I thought, well, I did do that, and it was the kind of first on telly. Yeah. But all I was doing really. Bringing what we teach in Classics courses. I mean, the fact that it was new was always seemed a bit surprising to me, because actually loads of my colleagues could have done this. You know, it was, you know, people have a very, very kind of austere and rather boring view of what teaching or learning classics must be like at university. But actually, it's just the kind of stuff that I do in my programmes. And... often people will say also things like, but it must be very different talking to a television audience, even a BBC Two audience. Mm. That must be different from talking to, you know, these brilliant Cambridge undergraduates. And say, well, it's not that very different. I mean, you know, an audience of 100 first-year Cambridge undergraduates are about as ignorant, actually, as the people who turn on the telly. You know, they might be clever, they might be interested, but you've still got to... get them even more interested, and they don't know anything. That's why they're first-year undergraduates. And in many ways, I think, you know, if it's a tribute, and partly of, you know, I don't mean to be false and modest, I mean, I put a lot of effort into it and all that kind of stuff, but I think it's a tribute to the subject and to the way we teach it, and it's a tribute, you know, it's seeing, really, you know... Okay... the university system, minus the nasty bits, minus the exams and all that kind of, minus the Latin translations and all that, but seeing that given to a wider audience. My undergraduates, when they watch the television programmes, they recognise it. They don't say, oh, you know, well, that's not what you teach us. Mm-hmm. It's what I've been teaching for the last 35 years.
And fits very, I mean, perfectly, actually, with the way you described the job of an academic, which is public service.
Yeah. That's right.
So offering that service to the public, yeah, in some ways fits very well with where you started.
You know, I can't imagine ever thinking about my job differently. I mean, I suspect that people who are coming into the profession now, by necessity, do. Yeah. They've been brought up with a different version of what a university is or who it's for and how it's funded, which I think makes their careers very different. But it just seems to me a done deal. And I think there's many different ways of doing it. You know, and I think, you know, in some ways you can serve the public by sitting on the fifth floor of the university library researching three lines of Euripides for 2 years. I think that, in some ways, that is also serving the public. So it's not one size fits all. But I think, basically, you have to be answerable to people who, even if they now don't pay for you to do it, at least allow you to. So I think that's, it's absolutely, it's a basic, you know, broadly soft socialist position about academic life, I think.
So on academic life, and of course you spent most of your career at a great British institution, and we sit here today in a public institution, facing probably some of the same challenges. You know, public institutions are looked at sometimes, especially these days, with a degree of, you know, misunderstanding, yeah, and mistrust.
Yeah.
And how we get the balance right between, you know, preserving the best bits,
yeah,
of tradition, of history, of longevity,
yeah,
while still being seen to be, you know, of the times, yeah, flexing with the societal shifts.
Yeah.
Help us think about, I mean, we're wrestling with this currently, but help us think about how we navigate a course, Mary, between
I think it's it's hard, and I do get angry, really, when people, as it's easy to do, you know, take pot shots, particularly Oxford and Cambridge, but other universities, as if somehow the dinosaurs that are holding the country back. You know, I think this is barking mad, actually. I think that every institution has to have an edgy conflict at its centre, yeah, you know, between tradition and revolution, right? And you know, the idea that the institutions should exist without conflict just seems to me to be short-sighted. And you know, I look at Cambridge and part of me says, look, I have lived through my career in Cambridge. I was there as an undergraduate in 1973, and I've taught there, though I taught in London for a little, since 1984. There's a revolution in Cambridge, yeah, over that period, in part. And when I was an undergraduate, there was 12% female undergraduates.
Wow.
It's now something approaching 50%. When people say Oxbridge never changes, the obvious answer is it completely diversified in terms of gender, its student body, in less than 30 years. And that was a change, a dramatic, really dramatic change. And it's one I feel proud of, actually, to have been part. I think that often some of the most radical institutions are those that have learnt to embrace their own conservatism. As I was saying to you before, Andy, I think I was very, very struck at one of the early meetings I went to at the faculty board, which runs our faculty. And it was back in the kind of what then seemed the early days of governmental intervention in universities in a very kind of hands-on way. And we had been asked to provide details for the university, which would then hand them to whoever was, you know, up the food chain in the Department of Education, how we were going to be able to respond quickly to government demands. And I remember an extremely clever philosopher around the table said something which it took me several months, I think, really, to see the importance and significance was. He said, the one thing we don't want to do is respond quickly to anything. And that is what, that is where the danger lies. You know, so no, we are not going to tell you, we are not going to respond quickly. Now, you know, one could easily parody that point of view, and one could easily say, well, you know, nobody's livelihood was at stake if the Cambridge Classics Faculty Board didn't respond quickly to some query or request, whereas other public institutions, much more rides on their ability to respond to crisis quickly. But, you know, I suppose I go back to the Romans again. This is one of the things that, one of the things that I've sort of learnt from Rome, and actually from Athenian civilization too, which is that Rome was a culture that dramatically reinvented itself the whole time. It underwent from about 500 BC to 100 AD at least. Almost constant social, political, and cultural revolution. And it managed that cultural revolution within a rhetoric of conservatism, which is things aren't changing. And very often, one has to, I think, in that standoff between the revolutionaries and the conservatives, and I think there's probably a revolutionary and a conservative inside everybody's head. You know, we're not all one or the other. I think one of the most important things to see is how you can deploy and exploit the rhetoric of things staying the same and enjoying that and appreciating it and understanding why that should be with what is de facto underneath that rhetoric. Something which is much more on the change and on the move. So I don't know whether I'm a revolutionary or conservative, and I suppose I'm both, but I think that every institution damn well needs both.
And what, that's fascinating.
Imagine living in an institution in which everybody was a revolutionary. Oh, God, wouldn't it be hell? Sheer hell.
Sounds all right. So I really like that point. So, going back in history then, if we thought of ancient Greece or ancient Rome, when decline set in, was that because of too much conservatism or too much revolution? Were they doing too little too late or too much too quickly?
If I knew the answer to that, I'd have written a book about it, I think.
Commission.
And, you know, we all know that one of the things that classicists and others, you know, from, you know, Aaron Banks to anybody, get off on is trying to speculate on why the Roman Empire didn't survive. And it would be much too... it would be simplistic to think that it was simply to be seen on a model of conservatism or revolution. I think that you might want to say that... In the end, there was huge adaptability. You know, what Rome did in the end was it kind of... Well, it went in for devolution, actually, on a, you know, on a very much United Kingdom model. But in the end, devolution turned into fragmentation. Maybe a lesson for us, I don't know. So I think that... I mean, I suppose I would say it was failed adaptation. Or it was an adaptation that rebounded on itself. And you know, one thing that did not happen was that, you know, Rome did not sit there kind of, you know, surveying a disintegrating empire and sort of, you know, fiddling on their lyres and not knowing what to do. They made all kinds of... They probably responded too quickly, actually. Might be the chance. But in a sense... The medicine proved the poison, and you've got so you actually had a fissure that devolution ended in disintegration. That's the 2-minute answer. You could do a more complicated one, but I think we'll leave it for later.
For the next book, can I ask you about your most recent book, Woman and Power? Which is about women not having had the voice.
Yeah.
as sufficient voice.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you whether you were optimistic. You mentioned the changes that Oxbridge had brought about, and we're trying to deliver change here as well on a similar sort of front, but are we winning? And how best do we win? Not just for, you know, for anyone who doesn't have a voice, and there's plenty within society that don't have a sufficiently loud voice right now.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to know the answer to that, you know, and I'm pulled in many different directions. Broadly, I am optimistic in some ways. I mean, as I said in the beginning of the book, my mum was born before any women had the vote in general elections, and she lived to see a woman prime minister, and she also would have said, much as she hated Thatcher, it had been a revolution. Now I think, I think there's a lot of work to do. In some ways, like, I can see, you know, me sitting here talking, being live streamed, saying women don't have a voice can look slightly odd, right? And, you know, I accept that. But I think that overall, there is still, women still don't get heard in the same way as men. I think there are a lot of other groups that don't get heard in the same way as men. And by concentrating on women in my book, I was writing about what I knew about. But one could put a lens of class or a lens of race on that, and you'd get similar and different answers to that question. I mean, I think for me the problem is that what the tipping point is actually now in our heads, right? It's about, you know, why women don't get heard, why women get, let's take a personal example, why you go on Question Time, and you get a completely different response on Twitter, email, and other forms of social media if you're female. You know, you will be accused of, you know, goodness knows, you know, you'll be accused of stupidity. You know, and I think, look, guys, you know, I might be wrong on all kinds of things, but I'm damn not stupid, right? You know, but women don't get, so people don't argue with you. They don't say, I disagree with you on that,
right,
which would be totally fair enough. Some of the things I say, I'm sure there are lots of people who should and probably rightly disagree with me. But I'm not silly, and I'm not stupid. And yet, in some ways, that is still okay to say to a woman. And it goes along with a lot of other ways in which we hear women's voices, how we describe them. I mean, you know, the idea of, you know, how many men are accused of whining? I mean, football managers, actually, occasionally are, but I don't know any others, right? Women, it's women and unsuccessful Premier League managers are accused of whining. And all the kind of stuff about stridency. And conversely, all the ways in which, you know, taking it broader than the voice, language is used to, broadly speaking, by women as well as men, to keep women out of power. I mean, if you say that the classic example for me, and I think I will not live, I think, to see a change in this, but I'd like to, you know, if you say of a bloke, he's ambitious, that is a compliment. You know, he's thrusting, you know, going places, phallic, you know, off he goes, right? Great. If you say of a woman, she's ambitious, you mean, what? That is not a compliment. You know, she's pushy, right? Don't say of a man, he's pushy. Women are pushy. You know, an ambitious woman is someone you don't really much like to be with, because she is going to, you know, stamp all over you, you know. And at that point, you start to examine many of the terms you use about yourself, about your voice, about the different virtues that are embedded in the language in which we speak about men and women. And you see, that's where the issues now lie. When I was a student, I thought that they lay much more in proper maternity leave, equal pay, you know, well, God help us, eventually, maternity provision, and getting more women into universities. And now I see that all those things were terribly important, but they haven't solved the problem. And I think it's one of the things I wanted to do in the book was actually, even if not offer a solution to the problem, was to help us see, and help myself see, that there is not a natural, but a very, very long-learned list of assumptions about how men and women behave. I'll just give you one example, because I don't want to make it look as if I'm not part of this too. I remember very vividly, it must have been about 15 years ago, I was on a plane, and it was that moment on an aeroplane when the pilot speaks and says, we're going to be flying at 30,000 feet or whatever, you know, etc. And it was a woman. And I still remember that for a split second, I thought, why is the cabin attendant making this announcement? And then, you know, instantly I thought, no, it's a female pilot, right? You know, but, you know, that moment when I had just so expected to hear a man, and then done that instant rationalisation in a completely gendered way, even though I've been somebody who's supporting the idea that women should be pilots for, you know, years. But even, you know, even me, us all, that we all hear women's voices differently.
Fascinating. Last question from me, so and then we'll pass over to you. So have your questions or comments ready. So this is my last question, Mary, which is actually not my question.
It's always a dangerous start. I'm taking no reason.
Far too clever. So if the Bank of England was a character or object from ancient civilization, which one would it be and why?
Well, I have to preface that by saying... as I should have said before, it's absolutely wonderful to be here in the Bank of England today, because I've never set foot in this building before. And I very much wanted to come and talk, but it was also a certain kind of idea of the exoticism of going to the Bank of England. So I'm not, I've got a very much outsider's view, and I suppose I've got two answers to that question. Right? One is a very kind of archaeological answer. There is a Bank of Rome in ancient Rome. If you go to the Roman Forum, you'll see the Temple of Saturn, the ancient god Saturn, at one end of the Roman Forum, sitting up just underneath the Capitoline Hill. And it was the state treasury in its basement. That was where all the gold bullion was kept. And it was the Bank of Rome. So you can actually go and visit. You know, this, interestingly, it was a temple. It was a holy, religious, and sacred space. That was the bank. People were always doing extremely naughty things there too, but ultimately, the Temple of Saturn is the Bank of England. They were always kind of robbing it, or, you know.
Oh, I can't, right.
No doubt other things too. But, so I think you can... Yeah, you can be an archaeologist, you can pinpoint that exactly. I think you're a kind of character. Well, I don't know if anybody's either read, I expect many of you have read, or now seen on stage, Robert Harris's trilogy of the life of Cicero, Imperium, Lustrum, or Dictator, which takes the life of Cicero from... almost his beginning to his death. Cicero is the only person in the ancient world that you could ever do that with, the only ancient person you can actually know in the way that you can know a modern historical character. And he was often written off, as I suspect the Bank of England has been, as a rather staid, boring, pompous old thing who people had to learn speeches of, and it was all frightfully, you know, frightfully dreary, and he was always sitting there in his toga. And one thing that Robert Harris has done as he's reread all of Cicero. And I think, you know, in a way, seeing your kind of point about the revolutionary versus the conservative, he's shown that Cicero is a sort of much more nuanced, funny, radical, vain, but changing, self-confident but anxious kind of character, who's really interesting to study and to make, you know, three novels and a seven-hour play out of. So I think that the combination of vanity, pomposity, anxiety and revolutionary reform is something that might possibly make him your emblem. Am I? Oh, obviously I'm right, yes.
Officially no comment. let's go to the audience and pop your hand up and maybe give your name with your question, if that's okay. Who wants to go? Let's go here.
Hello, Mary. My name is Alison Fisher, and I work at the Prudential Regulation Authority, part of the Bank of England. Now, I'm not going to ask you about financial services. I've got this perception that students aren't going to read classics at university anymore. That seems to have dropped off. And if I'm right, what steps can be taken to reignite the passion in classics?
I think the good news is that they are. But I suppose I've seen a big change over my kind of active career. And obviously one of the things that we face is the provision of Latin and Greek, but particularly Latin and classical civilization in schools. And I think that when I first started teaching at Cambridge, it was much, much more heavily independent school dominated. Now, that didn't mean, I mean, I think there's a bit of a myth that, you know, just because they went to independent schools did not mean they were thick. They were bright, rich kids, but they were still, we were drawing very heavily from one sector. And I think what's happened is that we have not, you know, there's still a long way to go, but we have partly broken that down. We've done it in two ways. One is by having now in Cambridge, and every university has some version of this, we have a four-year course. So if you haven't done Latin and Greek at school, you can come, and it's a bloody hard course, but it's really worthwhile. You can learn Latin and Greek from scratch, and you do a full classics degree. And that obviously appeals to people who, many of whom don't have the chance to do Latin at school. We've offered Greek from scratch since 1970. But also there's a lot of work going on in getting back classical subjects into state schools. And it's patchy, it relies on enthusiasm. You know, to be fair to him, I have many disagreements with Boris Johnson, but when he was mayor, he did back that as a kind of initiative in London. And there's a huge amount of effort in encouraging classical civilization and philosophy to get people interested in the ancient world. Because actually, if you get people interested in the ancient world and they're intelligent, you get them to want to go on with it, we can actually do the rest. Now, I think it is one doesn't want to sound complacent. In some ways, classics has been lucky in ways that modern languages haven't, because the worry about where the future generation of classicists was going to come from hit classics early enough for it to, in a sense, regroup, to think about itself, to get, make really effective partnerships with schools, not just kind of stay in the ivory tower. Mm. I mean, I look now at what's happening to modern languages. If you look at the A-level figures for German, you know, it makes Latin look, well, this is an exaggeration, but very soon, if it goes on that way, Latin will look healthy and German will have bottomed out.
Yeah. I did German at school because I was considered not intelligent enough to do Latin.
God, it's so much harder. Well, now you're a total rarity. And it's... and yet, modern language... When we first started worrying about, you know, about numbers, but also diversity of intake, I know my modern language colleagues were sitting... They didn't have to go to schools. They were just trying... You know, they were just kind of... You know, people were pouring in to read modern languages. And that has completely changed. So I think it's... You know, there's a wider problem, and I feel guardedly optimistic. I also think classicists are terribly nostalgic. And, you know, if you go back to the beginning of the 20th century, the founding of the Classical Association in this country, why was it founded? Because they thought that the subject was going down the tubes and no one was going to know Latin and Greek any longer. And I suspect that people have thought no one was going to know any Latin and Greek any longer from about kind of 400 AD, really. You know, because we're terribly gloomy, as well as, you know, it's another version of the revolutionary versus conservative. We're slightly optimistic, but also deep down, frightfully nostalgic.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions over this? If not, we'll go hand up here. Yeah, thank you.
Hello, I'm studying classics at A-level, and yay, and it's just me, actually, studying it. It's just me in the class. So I was wondering, is there someone in the modern day that you would compare to Odysseus?
Ooh. Oh, gosh, ooh. That's a political one.
Yeah, I see.
That is a political one. What am I going to say? Tricky, lying bastard. Terrible sex. I'm tempted to say Boris Johnson. I mean, but he'd be flattered. It's a wonderful character. And I think, you know, joke aside about Boris, I think that it is actually thinking about the nature of Odysseus as a hero. You know, and you know, what is he? He's always wily Odysseus. He's Polymates. You know, he's tricky. He's, you know, you can't trust him. You know, and there's this very, very famous scene in the Odyssey when Odysseus gets captured by the Cyclops, the one-eyed giant. And he's a one-eyed cannibalistic giant. And Odysseus has got to get his men away because they've been captured in the cave of the Cyclops. And what he does is he has a very clever idea that the Cyclops has only one eye. So first of all, he blinds the Cyclops in one eye. And then the Cyclops is still clever and he counts his sheep, counts everybody out. Like he lives in a cave, he's got one hole. And so even though he's blind, this blind now giant is counting the sheep out and checking that the blokes of Odysseus's party don't escape. So what does Odysseus do? He makes all the men hang out under the belly of the sheep so that as they go past, the Cyclops counts the sheep out and doesn't realise there's a little man underneath, cleverly escaping from the Cyclops' clutches. And when I was at school, we were taught this as the triumph of civilization over barbarity, right? You know, this was the wily, intelligent man versus the one-eyed giant. And as I read it more and more often ever since, I think, and he is a brutal, cruel Odysseus who takes a stake and drives out the single eye of this poor giant who's just looking after his sheep, right? And I think there are many politicians who you might want to compare with that. But Boris would be able to reel it off in Greek for you.
Let's go here, and then we'll go over here. Actually, we'll start there because the microphone's close.
Hi, Professor. I was wondering if you could speak a bit about when you are looking for a new topic, how do you go about deciding what topics to pursue? And then once you decide can you hear me? Yes. Once you decide on a new topic, how do you go about delving into it in terms of sources or methodology?
How do I decide what I'm going to work on next and then how I'm going to go about it? I think that's one of the most interesting and difficult to answer questions of all. And I think it's one that academics are always very bad at answering. You know, it's actually saying, how did I decide to write a book about that, and how actually did I do it? And I can't answer it any better than anybody. Usually to be realistic, usually I now write books because somebody says, will you write a book on this? Or will you give a series of lectures and we quite like it to be on that? And you know, I then revert to being a good undergraduate and I think, okay, that's what you want, I'll go and prepare it. And so I don't think I ever sit down and say, you know, what am I going to do now? But I was very struck by the way that academics are really, really bad at actually sharing those kind of decisions. When I was writing my SPQR book a couple of years ago, and I have to do this blog because I do it for the Times Literary Supplement. I have to do 2 a week. And usually I do it about what I've been doing, you know. And there's some things you can't talk about. You can't say Jenny wrote a very bad essay this week, but you can say I went to the Bank of England and it was good fun. When I was writing this book, I was doing nothing. I was just sitting at home and I thought, you know, what am I going to say? So in the end, I decided to actually share a bit of the process of writing the book. And I remember doing one blog which said something like, I'm really stuck with chapter 4 this week. And I'm trying to work out, you know, how to make it interesting and how to give it some character. And I thought, this is self-indulgent stuff I'm writing here. It was some of the most successful blogs I've ever written because people wrote and commented and said, no one has ever shared what it's like doing this. Now, I was still, it was very much on the mechanics. And it wasn't quite as big as the question that you're asking. But it is one, I think, you know, you can read any number of autobiographies of academics and you will never find the answer to your question about anything. You know, Kenneth Dover, one of the greatest classicists there ever was in the 20th century, who wrote, bizarrely, the first book about Greek homosexuality and also a book about Greek grammar. You know, and he wrote his autobiography and on neither of those topics did he ever mention to you why he'd done it? And it's something I think that academics, you know, ought to talk about. You know, why do you choose it? And what do you do next? You say, right, I want to do this, so what do I do now? Google is one answer, I have to say. But, you know. So it's a good question, and it's one that very few people ever manage to frame an answer to.
Hi, Mary. My name is Julius Carrington. I work for a bank, I think older than this one, so I shall leave it there.
Really?
Surely not true. Couldn't possibly be true.
No, it is true.
tell you what.
Barclays. I think we're about 4 years older. Well, I think given our history, our collective histories, we'll leave it there. women and power. My question, I'm going to ask two, if I may. The first is, do institutions like Newnham College, are they a necessity still in this day and age? And as a weary father of an ambitious 8-year-old girl, what do I do as a man to ensure that people don't tell her no, she can't? And I see that, you know, I can't put her in a cupboard and protect her from the bad world, but already the internal voice is saying, I can't do that, I shouldn't do this.
I think it's very hard. Now, Newnham is my college. Is a single-sex girls' women's college, one of very few surviving. I suppose my position on it is quite simple. If we were inventing British education again, you know, we would never have decided to educate girls and boys separately. It would have seemed a very odd thing to do if we were starting from scratch. But we're not starting from scratch. And I think that institutions like Newnham, I wouldn't stay there if I didn't think it still had a point. And you see, the point, I think, is very much in the critical mass of women that it has. Because I said very optimistically, Cambridge now has about 50% female undergraduates, and that's true. It's not going to surprise you to say the higher up the hierarchy you go, the fewer women you find. It's just the same as anywhere. And I think there is a case for saying, look, senior women are very, very thinly spread around different colleges. You know, there's a couple here, four here. What Newnham can represent is a way of women getting together. Now, I hope that one day Newnham will take men. I think it'll be a long time before that happens. So I'm not a kind of rabid ideologue for single-sex education, but I'm a practical one. And I think it's certainly supported me through, you know, having two young kids and, you know, being exhausted and all the kind of things. It was great to go to a place for lunch where I could say, oh, damn, I've forgotten the ballet shoes. And everybody around me understood what I was talking about, whereas my male colleagues didn't. So I think there's, you know, there's a point. I think on girls, I think the fact that you've asked the question is already part of the answer, isn't it? I mean, that you just have to be alert to the way that women and girls still get put down. There was a very interesting case with Dan Snow recently. I don't know if you saw it, that Dan Snow had taken his young daughter to a Spitfire Museum. And the daughter said, Daddy, did women pilot Spitfires? And he thought, oh, God. And so he decided to lie. And he said, yes. And he thought, look, I think it's, you know, and he got into terrible trouble in this, and support on Twitter for having done this. Because he thought, look, you know, a bit, you know, I think she's 8 or something. You know, a bit later, I can tell her it was a lie. But now, it's probably more important than she thought that they did. And, you know, but you can see, you know, that, you know, there isn't a right answer here. You know, and, you know, he said he didn't want to start the lecture, which said, well, now you can, but back then, you could, no, just say yes. So I think sometimes a bit of constructive lying probably helps.
Let's go, we're in short of time. Let's go up the top there, just directly behind you. Thank you.
Hi, sorry, this may fall on a bit from that Dan Snow point. Cicero, when he talked about, because so much was written about him and he also wrote so much about himself, you can get a surrounded picture. When you look back at the rest of history, so much of the writing that you use is written by a certain small sector of the population. So how much of what we read about history is fact and how much is just interpretation? And looking forward, the fact there's so much fake news now, somebody in 500 years... Mm. How would they ever arrive at the truth?
I think in terms of the ancient world, and it goes similarly but less extremely for many other periods of civilization, is that, you're right, not only, Cicero is the only person whose private letters we can really explore in any detail, the only person we can know. And almost everybody is elite male, almost all the writing that we have. Not entirely. I mean, one of the reasons you go to things like tombstones and papyri and the tablets from Vindolanda or whatever is that you do start to get a wider social view. It's still, if you reckon that maybe 50% of the ancient world was literate, still means you never see the illiterate. You know, we don't ever see them. Now, I think that one of the things one's doing is interrogating those sources. I mean, I think it's very clear, particularly for my students, about women. You know, you have one major female poet in the ancient world, that's Sappho, a little bit of writing from others. I think that it would be true to say that if you really wanted nothing more than to explore the experience of women, the Greek and Roman worlds wouldn't be a very happy place for you to specialise in, probably. But I think what you can do, and I think what is deeply revealing, is you can look at how these texts are gendered. You know, you can learn more about misogyny and the questioning of misogyny and how misogyny always brings out its own discontents, even in the most misogynistic, by looking at ancient writing. And I think that history is about interpretation and it is about fake news. And I think that a lot of my students start off being kind of worried that they're not getting to the truth. Right? They're worried that we don't really know and that actually you can't trust that writer and there's a different interpretation in this writer over here. I think that is quite destabilising when you start a university course. I think that one of the things that I want to try to encourage them. I mean, I want to throw them in the deep end and say, look, you know, you are in the middle here of trying to make sense of something. And in some ways, the process of that, seeing what the problems are, that is what we're about as much as getting to what really happened. If you really want to get to what really happened, we can't do that for 10 years ago. I tend to ask them, or I used to tend to ask them, that's now too much in the past, was Mrs. Thatcher a good Prime Minister? And they would instantly, you'd find that the room would split. And then you'd say, well, we're not going to say whether Nero is a good emperor then, are we? Right? and let's try to embrace all those difficulties and to see the clashes and the uncertainties and the inconsistencies and think that that's what the history is about rather than kind of fly off to trying to get the truth. I'm afraid I've given up there a bit, but I'm proud to have given up, you know, because I think it's about process. I mean, I think that goes back to the television programmes. One of the things that the producers always say, and they're right, is they say, look, Mary, don't always say we don't know. You know, it's a real downer. You're always saying, oh, we don't know this and we don't know that. And that is true, but it's, you know, people are going to turn off if all you're saying is we don't know. So what I think I found ways of doing now is to make how we might know an interesting story. That's the point. How might you know? You know, look, this is 2,000 years away. It's, you know, amazing we know anything. Actually. So let's kind of celebrate that and then think what the processes are by which we kind of half get there.
We've got time, I think, for one last question and two very last questions.
Okay. And we'll be having a drink and I'm very happy to be.
Hi, I'm Susan McKenzie. I work in the legal department of the bank here. I just wonder what you thought about some of these movements recently to remove statues of people who are considered historically controversial. Yeah.
I've had to debate that with myself. And I in the end decided I didn't want roads taken down. And yet I also found I did want the Confederates taken down. And so I thought, why am I so apparently inconsistent here? I decided that the statue to Rhodes, who was no doubt a racist, but was not put up to honour his racism. The statues to the Confederates were put up to them because they were racist. And I thought I could draw a distinction between those. What I really want people to do, though, I mean, when I walk through London, you know, I walk past loads of public statues of men, and I think not one of you wanted me to have the vote. And I kind of think, but you were wrong. So I would like, you know, I know it's not as easy to say this when we're talking about Rhodes and racism as when we're talking about, you know, Disraeli, you know, and white women getting the vote. But I think that one needs to engage with these and to make these statues, you know, face up to these bloody men, you know, not remove them, face up to them. And I was in the Codrington Library in Oxford recently, where they've still got, you know, the statue of Codrington in the library, all dressed up as if he was Julius Caesar. And it was, he made his money on the slave plantations in the Caribbean, and that's what the Codrington Library is built on. And, you know, what they've done is they've put up a very, very, much more tasteful plaque to the memory of the people who worked on the plantations that founded this library. So that you kind of see Codrington and you see this plaque. And you're not allowed to get away without looking that guy in the eye and thinking about what you think about him. And I think that's the way I would go. I think, you know, let's face up to history, not remove it.
Thank you.
And last question, Roz, here.
Roz Horton, I'm a risk manager. Do you have any advice for women wanting to enter public life on how to deal with the misogynistic social media reactions, either to mitigate or to build up resilience?
I think it's very hard to give a one-size-fits-all answer to that. I think that if you're going to be active in social media, you have to find a way that feels comfortable for you. And that isn't necessarily borrowing somebody else's way. So I remember when I first got, you know, really nastily trolled, people said, don't reply and block them. And I thought, I did that for a bit. I thought, I know what the right, I've been told, don't reply and block them. And I thought, but that means I'm shutting up. That means I am being, yet again, bullies left in charge of the bloody playing field, right? So I decided, after a few days of this, I wasn't going to do it. I was going to say, I'm terribly sorry, I didn't say that. No, try and be as polite as I can. And I felt much more comfortable. But I think that people often say, well, do you advise everybody to do that? And I think that, you know, you've just got to work it out for yourself. And I think, you know, when you're in your mid-50s and you're pretty resilient and you've got your career and you're not particularly bothered about how you look, it's much easier to say, no, I don't think my private parts do smell like a cabbage. You know, it's a bit easier to do that when you're 55 than when you're 25.
I can think of no better way to end than...